He came in. There was a heavy yoke upon you. There was oppression on you. Greeters, help me to keep the line in order. I want you to hear the word of the Lord tonight, the mid-year update. And I need you to have ears to hear. So we're going to deal with this thing even now. Just continue to sing that song in your heart. Oh, deliver me. Oh, God, deliver me. Oh, God, from fear, from shame, from rejection, whatever it is that's plaguing you, whatever voice you're hearing, just continue to cry out to Him. I want to hear voices singing. You can put the music back up, Pastor Austin.
The fear of serving others. From the fear of death or trial, from the fear of humility.
Come on, just cry out to God.
Deliver
us, God, tonight from every tie that binds, from the oppression of the wicked one, God, from the pain in our bodies, God. Would you deliver us, Jesus? You are the deliverer, God. Lead us here. Let your anointing break the yoke, Jesus. Who here has a broken heart or something wrong with either of this natural or physical, but there, I heard broken heart. Who is that? Who is that? That's you?
From the life of worldly
healed in Jesus' name.
Deliver me.
Jesus.
No, I shall not want.
I want my King for sure. Jesus.
Deliver me.
Now is the time. Now is your day. It's time. It's time. Now is your day. It's time. It's time. Come on.
Yes.
Understood. the greatness of it.
From the need to be accepted.
Father, touch my brother from the top of his head to the soul.
From the fear of
being
alone.
Father, you will find, Father, the door, knock and the door will be open. Lord, I thank you that you bless those who burn sin and don't just receive. Father, bless the Lord.
Praise God. It's going to be awesome. She's going to be with us July 28th, 29th, and 30th for the Activating Your Angels on Assignment Conference as well. I know we have thousands of people watching online. It looks like that camera right there is not working. This one is. This one's not. So you want to check on that one if it's supposed to be working. It should be. Praise God. I'm Jennifer LeClaire. I'm the senior leader here at the Awakening House of Prayer. How many of you are on my morning prayer calls? Anybody? Come on. Praise God. I'm glad there's not one tomorrow morning. That's about all I have to say. 6 o'clock rolls around early on a Saturday. But I do miss those prayer calls on the weekends. It's kind of like I'm glad I don't have to do it, but I wish I did kind of thing. I want to share with you tonight what the Lord is saying. Before I do, I want to remind you, I've got, I just came out like a week ago. It's called, it's a CD. This is me speaking with the background of music. I'm making declarations, and it's called Prayers That Activate Angels. And there's 31 prophetic decrees that deploy God's mighty messengers. How many of you know the Bible says in Psalm 103, verse 20, that angels hearken to the voice of God's word? Praise God. And you got some angel armies fighting for you, sister. Praise God. Aren't you glad? Praise God. We all do, but sometimes the Lord sends angels on assignment for a specific reason, for a specific season in your life. But we can also declare what says the word of God, and if it's according to the will of God, we're, in other words, if we're inspired to decree and declare a specific word, the angels will then hearken to that word because it's as if God said it himself. Now, we can't command angels. We don't boss them around. We can't just decide, well, I'm going to go have the angel get me my mail, praise God. I'm too lazy to go get it. There's got to be a check in there, too, because I don't want to get a job. No. We're not doing that. But this is the Bible, and this is out right now. Just came out. My new book, Angels on Assignment, again, is going to be in my hands next week. Praise God. Amen. I've been waiting on it. I've had so-called Christians cussing me out because there was a delay in the printing of the book because Jim Baker ordered 10,000 of them, and it sort of, he took priority over the rest of us and just kind of put a kink in the works, praise God. And people just nasty. I'm going to send you after him next time because you look like you could take out some mean-spirited Christians. Hands and feet ministry, you know, just the devils. Just the devils. This one here, I'm going to be with City Jacobs tomorrow. Woo! Praise God. Anybody going to the breakthrough thing in Miami tomorrow? You'll be there? All right, good, good, good. Well, I'll see you there. I'm going to be helping Cindy prophesy tomorrow, but she wrote the foreword to this book. It's called Waging Prophetic Warfare, and I've got like 20 books over there, but this is, if you're going through some warfare and you don't sort of, you're not seeing victory, you want to consider picking this up. Why? Because there are strategies in here, and there are tools in here, and there are teachings in here that will help you be led by the Spirit in warfare. And how many of you know, if you're led by the Spirit, you're always going to win? Because the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God to pull down of strongholds, right? So sometimes when we get in warfare, we get in the flesh. Well, none of you, of course. We do. We get in the flesh. We get in warfare and want to go eat pizza. We get in warfare and want to binge watch Scandal. Uh-oh. Oh, I didn't say that, did I? This one here, since we're on a prophetic thing, did the Spirit of God say that? How many of y'all ever got some goofy, loopy prophecy? Yeah. How many of y'all ever fell for it before you realized it was goofy? See? Because the prophecy that you don't judge could be the prophecy that destroys your life. Did you know that? I know too many people that have been prophesied, made states and babies, run off and quit their job, go on to the side of the universe, marry some hokey pokey from somewhere, and end up divorced, broke, busted, disgusted with three babies and a mess. Because some prophet told them they're supposed to, you know, how about the prophets that tell you you're supposed to divorce your mate and go marry another? This stuff's out there. But most of it's not so obvious. Most of it's very subtle. And most of it, it's just like if you're not really keen in the Spirit, you don't understand the principles of judging prophecy. There's 27 of them in here. 27 different angles that I've come up with based on Scripture to judge a prophetic word. And this one here, there's lots of t-shirts back there, but this one is one of my, I'm wearing one, come out of the cave. How many prophets do we have here tonight? Okay, you cannot actually operate in the office of a prophet if you don't have this shirt. You can't. It's impossible. It won't work for you. That's why you keep hitting the ceiling. I think I'm kidding. Try it. You know, I pray real well. I wrote some anointing on them, you know, so it's good. But this one's good, too. How many dreamers do we have? Dream wild. Dream wild. You got to dream wild. Lord told me that in last December. I began preaching that. Dream wild is one of the words that changed my life, is changing my life, and it's going to change my life. In January, I have a book coming out called Dream Wild, and actually we're going to have a, I don't know if we're going to have it here or not. We'll do a Dream Wild event here. I'm going to have a big Dream Wild conference and maybe several across the country, one in Texas for sure, because people need to dream again. You know why people live under the bridge? Not because they lost their job. It's because they lost their dream.
Amen.
They lost their hope. And so I wanted to just make you aware of that, and there's a ton of other stuff back there you can check out. But let's get into the word of the Lord. You know, I'm going to share this. I'm going to share some teaching, and we're going to pray again. And the Lord has been speaking to me about new beginnings since 2014. Now, what are we in, 2017? New beginnings, shifts, suddenlies. You know, all this, and I'm almost getting tired of it because it's like over and over and over. It's like the same, it's like, it's not the same word, but it's a variation on the word. I've had so many dreams of birthing babies. One time I had a dream and I birthed a baby, and the baby was looked like a, it was a baby, but it was like a full grown man, and he just started running. He just straight stepped and running, and like just right, just got birthed, popped out, just began to run. And what does that mean? It means it's like you labored, and then when the baby's finally born, it's almost like a full grown minute. You can't know, you know, he almost looked Italian. He had hair, and you know, it was. I wrote about it. I've had this sequence of baby dreams, and it's like, dear God, are you serious? How many more things can I birth? Praise God. I guess more. But he's been speaking to me that. Then in January, sort of catching you up prophetically, because I don't know how many of you have been following what I've been saying, what I've been preaching and teaching. But at the beginning of this year, the Lord spoke to us. He said it was the year of the next. The year of the next. What is that? Next level assignments. He said three things. Next level assignments, next level warfare, and next level blessings. Next level blessings. We like that part. See, everybody said amen on that. When I said warfare, it got quiet. Like a Presbyterian church. It was just like, all the anointing left the room. And then in I don't know, maybe it was, gosh, might have been February, might have been March. I don't remember exactly. But the Lord started speaking to me about mega. Hashtag mega. And I did not release that until May, because it wasn't the time. He told me mega faith and mega grace equals a mega movement. And then he proceeded to give me a fuller word on that. At the end of it, he said three things that I like. He said, it's time to move. Yes. It's time to move. And so that brings us up to authorized payback. We went through all these things. But I started feeling rumblings in my spirit about that time in May. I began to feel rumblings. I didn't know what was about to happen, but I knew it was going to be good. I knew it was going to be exciting. I knew it was going to be explosive. Praise God. I knew it was going to be a lot of things. And probably, you know, here's the thing. God always shows us like the end part. But what I realized after I stepped into it was that there's like all this hell that you have to go through to get to the end. It's kind of like you driving across the country to go to Disney. It's like, you know, if you'd have known how hard it was to get there, you probably would have flown. You know, but it's like God shows you the end. But if he showed you all the hell you had to go through to get the prize, you would just say, that's all right, I'm good. I'll just stay right here, I'm fine, I'm liking my life. So I began to press, I began to feel the rumblings. And in June, the Lord began to speak to me about mega transition. Mega transition. And I sat on that for probably just a couple of weeks. And about a week before, the Lord, it was rumbling. I didn't know how to express it. I was juggling with it in my spirit. Like, what are you trying to say? How do I express this? What does this mean? What label do I put? Like, what words do I use? I didn't have the words. Sometimes you have a feeling in your spirit, and you don't have the words to express what your spirit is sensing. So I wrestled with that for a while, and I finally drilled it down to mega transition. And I saw, listen, I saw mass transit moving people from one place to another. Mass transit. Let me pray. Father, I thank you for the anointing of the Spirit of God. I thank you, Lord, that you are here, that you are with us, that you've come to meet us in this place to speak to our hearts. I thank you, Lord, that you give us ears to hear what you're saying to the church, what you're saying to the body of Christ, what you're saying in this hour. God, would you help us to take this piece of the puzzle and put it in position, that we might have a clearer picture of what you're doing in our life, of what you're about to do in our life, of what you want to do in our life. Would you help us, God, in the name of Jesus, to do what you've called us to do? In Jesus' name, I thank you, Lord. Praise God. Well, I'm not going to take this because I already did. All right. So let me read you the prophetic word. How many of y'all want to hear it? Yeah. All right, if you don't want to hear it, leave now. How many of y'all want to hear it? Yeah. Amen. All right. All right, here we go. Lord, here's what I heard the Lord say. Listen closely. I'm telling you, all you online as well, this is going to answer a lot of questions for a lot of you. I know thousands of people are watching all over the world. This is going to answer a lot of questions for a lot of you. Praise God. Is that actually able to see? Is that camera actually? No, it's not working?
It's not
on. Okay. All right. All right, here we go. The first 6 months of the year has prepared your heart for what I am doing next, says God. The key word is next. There is next after next after next after next for you in the second half of this calendar year. There is mega transition, says God. There is massive change, says the Lord. There are sudden shifts that you've been thinking about, talking about, and praying about, and sudden shifts that you never imagined could or would happen. I am moving you closer to your dreams, says God, closer to your destiny, closer to those who can help you make the connections you need to succeed in what I've called you to do, says the Lord. For this mega transition is all about my kingdom and my purposes in your life and in the earth. So embrace the mega, says God. Embrace the next. Embrace the transition, and you will see that I have made the crooked places straight. The forces that opposed you in past seasons, says God, will now be powerless to thwart you, because I have prepared you to overcome what tried to overcome you just months ago, says God. I have readied you for victory against old enemies, says the Lord. I have given you mega grace, and your mega faith will drive a mega movement in your life. The Lord says it's a mega transition. Hallelujah. You heard it first. Hallelujah. How many of you need a mega transition? Well, hallelujah. Hello, 420 Fire. Are you from Orlando? How many of you need a mega transition? How many of you are in a mega transition? Well, I say I got the right word at the right time. Hallelujah. Praise God. It's a mega transition. Well, what happens in mega transition is things become unfamiliar to you. Sometimes things get a little scary to you. You don't know which way is up. You want to sort of sometimes go back to where you were because it's more comfortable. Sometimes you just have to break out of your comfort zone. You know, Lord told me earlier this year that it's time to break out of your comfort zone and into the abundant zone. You can't stay where you were and expect to get where God wants you to go. You can't stay back here in the past and expect to advance into the future. You can't hold on to things God said, drop it, and think you're going to pick up what he says, get it. It doesn't work that way. You've got to press. How do I do this? How do I do it? What do I do? How do I press? What am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to deal with this? I'm going to give you some keys. Would that be all right? I'm going to teach you why. Because I believe that in the prophetic ministry, we have a lot of words that are delivered that are good words. But what happens is the prophet blows through, and because they're itinerant, they don't have the time to teach the principles on how to apply the word that just delivered. They're thinking the pastor's going to do it. But many times the pastor doesn't do it because they don't know they're supposed to do it. But I feel like in this hour, in the prophetic, there's going to be, listen to me, I'm prophesying to you now, there's going to be a paradigm shift in the prophetic where the prophets begin to work with teachers. If they can't teach it themselves, they partner with teachers. Why? Because in the book of Acts, you see what happened. Prophets and teachers were working together. Is that what it says? The prophets and teachers were working together. Hallelujah. I believe God is calling forth prophets that have also a teaching anointing. Praise God. But if they don't, they're going to connect and hook up with teachers, and they're going to help. One's going to prophesy, the other's going to unpack it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to give you some keys to completing your mega shift. Now, you all know these things. This is not deep. It's Bible. The Bible is not actually deep. You know, the Bible was written so that anybody could understand it. It was King James that made it all ith and oath and thou and thine, and in a language we can't possibly understand. It was King James that did that. But the Bible was actually written to the common man, to the common denominator. So it's all very simple. But here's the thing. We can read it, but do we do it? Shaking. And what happens is that we're going through a shift, we're going through a transition, something's shaking, something's shifting, something's happening, and we forget what we knew. We don't know what to do anymore. We can tell, you know, you can tell me what to do all day, but you go through it and it's like, wait, what? What am I supposed to do? You just forget. You just forget because you're in the middle of the chaos. You're in the middle of the witchcraft. You're in the middle of the hellfire. You're in the middle of the being conformed into his image. You're dying to self. You can't see straight. So in that's what happened. The Lord told me earlier this week. He told me this. He said, He said, the trial often precedes the transition. It's a good word. I know you don't like it, but it's a true word. A trial often precedes a transition. And I think the reason why is because we're reticent to let go of whatever it is God is wanting us to let go of. There's this war in our soul. The flesh wars against the spirit. The spirit wars against the flesh. God is trying to get us to move out, and we won't do it. So what happens? Our circumstances become miserable. Things become unbearable. People that we used to run with, that we used to enjoy, all of a sudden they start stabbing us in the back. What's happening? God is trying to transplant you. He's trying to move you from one place to another, from one camp to another, from one group of friends to another, to people that you are called to. You know, some friendships are seasonal. Did you know that? Some are for a lifetime. Others are for a season. We've got to learn to discern when the season ends, and we've got to shift. That's why sometimes it's so hard. That's why, because the trial comes because we're actually resisting God many times.
Wow. Come on.
Not always. Sometimes it's just the devil, but sometimes it's where that we're resisting God. So number one, what do you do? How do you shift? Mega shift. I'm going to ask you some questions. This is for your own reflection. You don't have to answer out loud, but you can think about it later. How much do you trust God? How much do you trust God? How much do you trust Him? Lord showed me maybe 2 years ago, maybe three, that whenever I got upset, whenever I got anxious, whenever I got angry, whenever I got frustrated, that it was a sign that I wasn't trusting God. Because when we trust in Him, we're peaceful. Why wouldn't we be? If you really believe Romans 8:28, God will work all things together for your good. To those who are called according to His purpose and who love Him. If you really believe that, why would you be upset? So when we're upset, when we're anxious, when we're fearful, we're not trusting God. But here's the thing. Here's the problem. You won't follow a God that you don't trust. You won't. You won't wait on a God that you don't trust. You won't wait on Him. And you know what happens when you won't wait on God? You know what sometimes we do when we don't want to wait on God anymore? We get out ahead of Him. We try to shift in our flesh. We try to shift in the intelligence of our mind. We try to shift based on what Bobby Joe told us and Susie has said. You know, we try to shift, and sometimes then we end up with an Ishmael. We end up with a big mess on our hands because we've shifted apart from God. We've shifted in our own trust in our own self. Bible says, trust not in our own understanding. Lean not on our own understanding. In all our ways, the preacher said, acknowledge Him, and He'll direct our paths. But we don't want to wait. We don't want to wait sometimes. We get an issue now. See, God showed me that some of you are walking around the mountain, and you're walking around, and you're walking around, and you're walking around, and you're walking around, and you're walking around. There's like a rut around that mountain. You're just walking around, and you're walking around. God wants you to stop walking around the mountain, and He wants to put you on top of the mountain. Amen? He really does. But you've got to listen to Him. You've got to hear what He's saying. You've got to follow Him. You've got to trust Him. We don't always want to do what He says. We don't. He gives us a word. It's like, well, I don't. The Lord said something to me one time, and I didn't like it. You know, I did. I said, "I bind you, devil." The Lord said, "You can't bind me." And so I learned. I learned that sometimes the Lord will say things that you don't like, but you still have to obey. The Lord says, "If you love me, you'll obey me." Is that what Jesus said? If you love me, but not just when you like it, not when it feels good, not when there's prosperity, but even when it means dying to self, even when it means picking up your sword and fighting, when you're weary, you don't even want to fight anymore. No matter what, obey the Lord. There's many shifts. Trusting God means walking by faith and not by sight. See, we can't see. So many times we can't see. The Bible says we know in part and we see in part. See, trusting God means not having all the answers. Trusting God means being willing just to take one step at a time, just to follow Him, just to not having to have all the answers. We can't always see with our natural eyes, but we can discern Him by the Spirit. we can discern it by the Spirit. Yeah, thanks, Lord. Lord says sometimes people trust what the devil says about them more than they trust what I say about them. They trust what the devil says about their future more than they trust what I've told them about their future. We put our trust in the fear-laced words of the wicked one instead of the life-giving words of the Almighty One, the Eternal One. We've got to stop that. But it's a matter of discerning what the Lord is saying, what the enemy is saying. Faith and patience, the Bible says. We inherit the promises of God by faith and patience, not faith of frustration, not faith of manipulation. Faith and patience. Patience has become a cuss word in the body of Christ. Everybody wants a drive-through breakthrough, drive-through deliverance, drive-through church. You know they have drive-through prayer now? Dear God. They do. Drive-through prayer. Like, you get your dry cleaning done and you get a prayer way out. It's true. They got drive-in church now. They got drive-in churches. Drive-in. It's true. I wrote a story about it. Drive-in church, drive-through prayer, drive-through breakthroughs. Drive through, cast your devil out. We don't have that yet. Maybe we should start that. I know it's hard, but you've got to trust the Lord. If it's easy, everybody would do it. You've got to trust the Lord. So when you're in the middle of the shift, and all hell is breaking loose, and it seems like everything's uncomfortable, you don't know which way you're going, just trust in the Lord. He's got you. On the prayer call this morning, Lord began to prophesy, I got you. I got you. I got you. I've got your back. I've got your front. I'm your real guard. I'm your rear guard. I go before you. He's got you. Number two, as you go through your mega shift, do you know the Word of God? Yeah, I know the Word. Do you really know the Word? Because we forget it. Faith comes by hearing, Romans 10 and 17. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. See, if you know the Word, then when the devil comes to challenge the Word of God in your life, if you really know the Word, if you really, really, really know the Word, then when the enemy comes, you're going to say, it is written. See, that's how Jesus did spiritual warfare. I'm about to get shot, and I like shout. We might shout later. I like to scream at the devil and holler and make sure he knows I'm alive. I'm all for it, but Jesus did warfare by saying, it is written. Yeah. Amen. And we do better to incorporate some of that in our modern day spiritual warfare practices. And just, you know, put the Word in it. Because it's the Word that's this two-edged sword, right? It's the sword of the Spirit that does the cutting in Jesus' name. If you want to build your faith for the shift, you need to do like what Jeremiah said. What Joshua told Jeremiah, in other words. Joshua 1 and 8. Joshua 1 and 8. The Bible says, meditate on my word day and night. Not just when you feel like it. Not just when you're going through a trial. Not just when you want something really bad from God. Not just when there's nothing good on TV Thursday night. Meditate on the word day and night. The Bible says, be careful to do all that it says. Not some of what it says. Not half of what it says. I mean, understand, we try to like twist up the word up, but like, I'll meditate on it on Thursdays. I'm going to do some of what it says. Well, if you do some of what it says, you're going to get some of what God says you can have. Oh, see, I don't like me no more. A minute ago, you were shouting. Now you're like, I don't like this. Meddle in my business. He told Joshua, meditate on my word. Joshua 1 and 8, day and night. And be careful to do all that it says. And then, after you've done this, and then, that's a conjunction, then you will find good success. And this was as he was about to go into war. This was about he was about to bring the Israelites into the promised land. This was about he was doing something that Moses didn't get to do. He didn't finish it. He didn't bring them in. And it was handed off to Joshua. And he was about to go dispossess the former occupants. He said, be strong and courageous. If you want to find good success in the transition, you've got to be careful to do what the Word says, including prophetic words. How many of y'all have prophecies over your life? A few of you? Pray you haven't been hanging around here long enough then. If you've got a prophecy over your life and it's judged to be true, now it's not on par with Scripture. Prophecy is not on par with Scripture. But if it really came out of the mouth of God, see, the Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That means God's still speaking. So if you have a prophetic word and you've judgment be true, then you can do what 1 Timothy 1:18 says. You can wage war with the prophecy. You can wage war with it. You put it in your mouth and you speak it. You put it in your mouth and you declare it. You decree it. You confess it. You swing that sword in Jesus' name. You can do that, but you got to fight. You got to fight. It's not the word that you know that will defeat the enemy. It's the word that you act out. It's the word that you speak out. It's the word that's in your heart that has changed your mind, that it comes out of your mouth, that charges your actions, that will set you free. That's what will set you free. Hallelujah. Praise God. Knowing and acting on the word will help you in times of transition. It brings stability to your soul. When the warfare rises against you, it's your weapon in victory. Number three. Are you yielded to the Spirit? Really? Are you really yielded to the Spirit? You're either going to yield to the Spirit, to the flesh, to the devil. One or the other. One of the three. Are you yielded to the Spirit? James 4:7 in the Amplified Version Bible says, so be subject to God. King James says, submit yourself to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. But I like what the Amplified Version says here. It says, resist the devil, and then it says in the brackets, stand firm against him. Stand firm against him. You've got to stand firm against him. And not after he's already whacked you a few times, but another, I think it's in Peter, 1 Peter, where he talks about stand firm against him. It says at his onset. So as soon as he begins to attack, that's when you have to resist. You don't wait till you're on your back, moaning and groaning and wondering what happened to you to start resisting. No. It's harder then. You're already oppressed then. You're already regressing then. You're already on your way to needing deliverance then. Praise God. How many of y'all have a devil I can cast out? Oh, no, we already did that. Come back in August. We'll do it again. You probably get one by then anyway. I'm kidding. Oh my gosh. You're like, what? I'm not one who believes that you always have devils. There's certain deliverance preachers out there that are rising in popularity, and their mantra is, I got devils, you got devils, we all got devils, nobody ever gets fully free of the devil. It's like, well, what's, dear God, like, that's discouraging. That's depressing. I mean, yeah, we go through a season of deliverance, and maybe on down the line, God puts his finger on something else, but my God, I mean, if we're just full of devils all the time, we've got issues. Now, I do think the one preaching this does have a devil. I think he's got seven devils, like Mary Magdalene. Yeah, probably the same ones. Oh, boy, I stepped into it, didn't I? That's what makes it fun. Obviously, you know, I've been delivered of you, so I don't really care. Learned that a long time ago. You can't do anything great for God if you're going to be scared of man. Praise God. Somebody's got to correct these false theologies that are propagating in the body of Christ. You know, all Christians don't have demons till they die. Some might, but all don't, dear God. I'm not going to go down that path. Yielding to the Spirit of God won't eliminate all warfare in your shift, but it will produce peace in the storms that often comes in transition. So the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you to all truth. He'll lead you and guide you through your transitions. We just have to remain sensitive to His Spirit. He's trying to talk to you all the time, guys. He's always trying to talk. He's always trying to communicate with you. It's just that we're not always hearing Him. We're not always hearing Him. And here's the thing, too. Y'all aren't going to like this either. But I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you, Praying John. Sometimes He'll ask you to sacrifice something you don't want to sacrifice in order to shift. You know, I've only done this a few times, I guess, ever. I've done it a few times. I don't know how many. Probably five times. I don't know. A few times. A few is less than five, right? I've done it a few times. Where I've just taken everything. I didn't know what to do. Wasn't sure what I was supposed to hold on to. Wasn't sure what I was supposed to let go of. Wasn't sure what to do. And so I just did this. I don't know if I learned it from an old Pentecostal woman. I just put everything on the altar. All of it. You too, brother? Is that a demon laughing? Or are you just... No. Doesn't sound like a demon. tell. Pitch.
I just put it all on the altar. My battery dead now? See, the demons start messing with me when I start talking about demons. How is that? Somebody sing or something.
Come back, kid.
Come back, kid. Where's the comeback kid?
Oh, that was
all right.
Retro.
No pressure there, Pastor Sierra. We're not waiting to hear what I said or anything. And sacrifice your beloved son. And that was the son of promise. It was what he had waited for. He had waited and believed God for like 20 years, something longer than 20 years. He wanted the son more than anything. And God said, go up this mountain and sacrifice your son on the altar. And he was willing to do it. See, sometimes the Lord will cause you in a mega transition, in a mega shift, to just sacrifice some things. But sometimes it's not that he actually wants you to sacrifice it. It's that he wants you to be willing to sacrifice it. And when you put it all on the altar, when it's all said and done, he'll actually give it back to you in a better form, in a better shape, in a better way than you had it before. You'll have more joy. You have more peace with it. It's just, so sometimes it's when I don't know what to do, I learned that from an old Pentecostal lady in Alabama somewhere. Just put it all on the altar. Let God do with it what he wants. Because if God don't, yeah, let me just tell you something. I don't know about you, but if God doesn't want me to have it, I don't want it. I don't want it. I don't want it. Why? Because it's not going to be nothing but trouble. Not going to be nothing but trouble. I've learned not to hold on. We're gonna buy a piece of property in North Carolina. And one thing, I get upset about certain things, but one thing I don't get upset about is when things just kind of don't seem to work out with different deals or different, you know, jobs or different, you know, I just always feel like, you know, I've been through enough of it where I'm like, I know that God has something better. And he's actually protecting me from getting involved in something that's an Ishmael, or that's less than. See, some of the reason why some of you haven't shifted completely is because you're trying to shift towards something lower than God's best for you.
Wow.
He wants your thinking to be up here, and you want to settle over here. And so the reason why you haven't moved from the place where you are to the place where he wants you to go is because you think the place he wants you to go is right here, but it's actually way up here. So he's waiting for you to catch up with him. He's waiting for your faith to rise. He's waiting for your understanding to increase. He's waiting for you to catch the drift, praise God. Number four, how is your prayer and fasting life? Somebody groan. I did. It was you, right? I know I heard somebody groan. You win the honesty award tonight, man. See, prayer is our lifeline to God, and fasting crucifies the flesh. And when you put the two together, it's like a pop, pop, one, two in the spirit. Pop, pop. One, two in the spirit. It's powerful. It's powerful. It's powerful in times of transition, especially when you don't know what to do. See, fasting doesn't change God. That's what some people think. Well, if I just fast, my baby will get healed. It doesn't change God's will. It doesn't change God's mind. It changes you. It changes now. Fasting will make you more sensitive to the spirit. Why? Because you're putting down your flesh. You're crucifying your flesh. You're saying, I'm not being led by my flesh. I am a spirit. I have a soul. I live in a body. Paul said, I buffet my body. He didn't say, I buffet my body. He said, I buffet my body. You got that praying, John? I know Vanessa will let you eat at buffets, so I don't think we have to worry about it. Of course, you probably have a buffet at home. I'm picking on you tonight, brother, because it's fun. Uh-huh.
Now I forgot where it's going. In time of transition, we don't know how to pray as we ought. Here's the thing. We can pray with our understanding. We should. It's good to pray with our understanding. But, you know, one of these days, I might preach a message where I don't talk about praying in the Spirit, but it's not going to be today. That's like my answer for everything. Pray in the Spirit. Why? Don't you have anything else to say? Yeah, I've got a lot to say, but, you know, if you don't do that, if you're not filled with the Spirit, you need to get filled with the Spirit tonight. See, the Bible says that Jude 20 says that when we pray in the Spirit, that we are building ourselves up in our most holy faith. Building ourselves up, we're edifying ourselves. We're building ourselves up. We're making our spirit man stronger. So why? So we can be more sensitive to a spirit. We can be led by a spirit. But never forget, when I was in Nicaragua, it was hotter than 19 hells, as my grandma would say. I was carrying, yeah, it is. I don't like it. Hope never to go back. But I went there every year for 8 years and doing missions work, praise God. And I was carrying heavy video cameras and doing documentaries of the work that we were doing there. And I'd come home and edit them. But I remember one time you were there with me, Karen. Karen was always with me, praise God. She didn't like it either. She pretended she did, though. Well, you did the fashion shows with the ladies. I was, yeah, never mind you. So I was there, and it was hot, and one of the apostles said, come over here and sit next to me. And I'm like, praise God, nobody can get mad at me. The apostle said I could come sit next to him, hallelujah. I'm going to drink some water. And he began to speak to me about praying in the Spirit. And he said, when a man speaks in an unknown tongue, his mind doesn't understand what he's saying, but in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. That's all he said. It was a scripture from 1 Corinthians. And I was waiting for him to say something else. And he just started praying in tongues. And that's all he did. I sat there for about another 15 minutes and I got pulled away. But I began to pray in the Spirit constantly from that moment forward. I sat there and prayed with him. And I continued to pray all throughout that trip. I think the temperature went down a couple of degrees. It was awesome. But when we pray in the Spirit, we're unlocking mysteries. We're speaking mysteries. We're unlocking mysteries. You know there's a book of mysteries over your life? The Lord's not trying to keep your mega transition a mystery from you. Sometimes he is because you go ahead and get out in front of them. You go ahead and make a mess of it. Well, not you, but all those watching on the internet. Hi. So, but sometimes he's actually hiding it from the devil. He's protecting the mystery of your life. So you see, when you speak in tongues, the devil can't understand you. When you speak in tongues, you're praying a perfect prayer. When you're speaking in tongues, the Holy Spirit's praying with you. He's helping you do the heavy lifting. It's almost like if you were moving and you had a heavy table and you picked up one side, then the Holy Ghost picked up the other side and moving that thing on. And so when we're in transition, we must pray in the Spirit as much as possible because we don't know how to pray as we are. We think we know how to pray. We think we know what God is doing. Or sometimes we know we don't know what God is doing, but we need to pray in the Spirit. We need to pray in the Spirit. Like right before, yeah, go on and pray in the Spirit, girl. Keep on praying. People don't like it when I do that. In the middle of my message, they get mad. The religious devil starts. They gnash their teeth at me. You can't do that. I just did. Praise God. So you pray in the Spirit. You pray in the Spirit. You pray in the Spirit. You keep praying in the Spirit. I remember once it was about December. It was December, last December. And the Holy Spirit told me, pray in the Spirit more. So what do you mean more? I pray in the Spirit when I wake up, pray, go to bed, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit when I'm going to the bathroom. I pray in the Spirit when I'm cooking my dinner. I pray in the Spirit when I'm riding my car. What do you mean more? Y'all need to pray the Spirit. Well, I can tell you, like, I don't even pray in the Spirit 5 minutes. Like, yeah. I pray in the Spirit. So go to the bathroom. I pray in the Spirit in the shower. I try to pray in the Spirit when I'm on hold. I used to pray in the Spirit in the gym. Did I ever tell you that time I was on the treadmill?
That was great.
And I was on this team, you know, we're like in competition with other teams. And I was on the treadmill. And I forgot I was in the gym, and I started, I have my eyes closed, and I'm running, I'm popping, I'm winning. I look next to me, and I'm like, and the lady there went, I was like, wait, what? She said, you getting warmed up there? I said, yeah, I'm breaking through. I'm going today, praise God. I pray in the Spirit all the time. See, when you pray in the Spirit all the time, you just start start busting out in tongues, like in strange places. I'm in Whole Foods, and I see a good watermelon. I'm like, oh, Ramashalia. Oh, the filet mignon is on sale. Ah, shit, good too. Grass-fed organic. Yes, Lord. Praying John brings home some mahi-mahi from the Bahamas. I'm like, whoa, shakata. Yes, Lord. You just start busting out. See, when the devil pokes you, what's in you is going to come out of you. When the devil pokes me, you know what comes out? You figured it out. Yeah. When the devil, some of you, the devil pokes you and something bad comes out. It's not a shift, it's something else. We're in church. Y'all shouldn't be thinking like that. That's not what I meant. Not terrible. Oh, got the Rodney. Every time Pastor Austin comes, we got that Rodney Howard Brown spirit coming here. Pray in the spirit. What comes out? Let me poke you. Let me just see. Nothing came out! Try again. All right, here's the next point. Number five. Number five, you're messing me up. Don't try to hurry me. My church, I get to talk as long as I want. You know, Paul preached so long one time that a kid fell out the window and died? Aren't you glad we're not upstairs? But they raised him from the dead. People got saved. It was worth it. Number five, don't mess with me now. Are you on fire for God? Praise God. Are you on fire for God? We got 420 fire in the house, praise God. Yes, I like you, praise God. Hallelujah. Are you on fire for God? So you got to pursue. There's no better time to, you should pursue intimacy all the time. When you're in transition, by God, you better get real close to God, because I don't want to end up, you know, in Egypt. I don't want to end up taking a wrong turn. Oh, I'm coming after you, prophet. Pursuing it through God should be a lifestyle, not something we do when we're desperate or in transition. But you live by Psalm 27, being a person of one thing. You know, some people say, well, I just lost my fire. If that's you, you're going to get refired tonight. Praise God. To get refired tonight. You know, sometimes you go to these meetings and you see people. I go to a lot of revival meetings, and people are on the floor and they're crying out to God, and they're, we just did upgrade. There's one guy, and every video I see, he's on fire. And then you see these other people next to him. And I'm like, what's wrong with you? How could you be in this kind of environment? Why? Because religion sometimes puts out your fire. Because Jezebel sometimes puts out your fire. But you need to get refired. You know, sometimes you just get desensitized to the presence of God because of what you've been taught or what you just had to fight. But you know, but if you get in the presence of God long enough, it's like a pound of frozen hamburger, like your heart, like a pound of frozen hamburger. Organic grass-fed, of course. And if you put it in front of that fire long enough, it'll start to thaw. That cold heart, that cold meat, it'll start to thaw. And if you leave it in front of that fire long enough, it'll catch fire and it'll burn. And we need to be like John the Baptist. We need to be those that burn and shine. Praise God for Jesus. We've got to burn. We've got to turn off the TV, turn off the cell phone, turn off Facebook for 5 minutes. Or except you can go to my Facebook. Yeah, because I got good stuff on mine, none of that bad stuff. Sometimes our hearts get hard because of sin, because of offense, because of whatever. Number six, have you determined not to quit? Have you determined that? See, the best time to determine things is before you go through something. You can decide ahead of time. Listen, this will help you. you determine in your heart ahead of time how you're going to respond, how you're going to react, how you're going to deal with a situation when it arises, then when it comes, you will respond instead of reacting. Because the devil wants you not to only react, but overreact.
Yeah.
So if you decide ahead of time that come hell or high water, no matter what comes my way, no matter what I have to go through, what I have to walk through, no matter who runs away, I'm not going to quit. If you decide that now, then when hell comes against you, you'll stay strong. You'll endure. You'll have a steadfast spirit. I've always said that the best thing I've got going for me is that I just refuse to quit. We've all had plenty of reasons to quit, right? I've written my resignation letter to God I don't know how many times. Actually, I just took the old one and edited it, you know, made some changes, applied it to the current situation, and sent it heavenward. But the Lord will never accept my resignation letter. He won't accept yours either. Because you're called to do something great. This mega transition that you're walking through, that you're going to walk through, is bringing you to a greater place. It's bringing you to a happier place, a more joyful place. It's bringing you to a place of strength. It's bringing you to a place of greater prosperity, of greater health. It's bringing you to a place that eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, nor has been found the heart of man. God has so much more for you than you can possibly see with your natural eyes. And I know it's hard to believe now. Some of you came in here tonight and you're just going through flat out hell. I know it's hard to believe there's a future to hope for you, but God says there is. When Israel was in the midst of judgment, they were in the midst of judgment, in judgment. Jeremiah prophesied, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans for a future and a hope to prosper you." In the middle of judgment, in the middle of their sin, God has a plan for you, to prosper you, to give you a future and a hope. You can't quit. What do you do if you quit anyway? Seriously. Go camp out in hell a while? I mean, what are you going to do? You can't quit. You can't quit. You got to determine your heart ahead of time, not to grow weary. Got just two more quick ones, then we're going to pray. Number 7, whom are you aligned with? So your connections matter. The Bible is in Ecclesiastes 4:12, the threefold cord is not easily broken. But if you're tied to the wrong people, you could unleash a bad flow in your life. Psalm 1:1, blessed is the man who does not take the counsel of the ungodly.
Amen.
We're not to take counsel of ungodly people. If we go through trials, it's almost anybody that will listen to us, we'll just take their advice, even if they're not godly people. We're not supposed to walk with the corrupt. The devil will send people to work against your shift. He'll send all kinds of people to come against your mega transition. But here's what I found. I want you to really, really catch this about alignments. About alignments. I live in a condo on the beach. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. Don't be jealous. People want to be jealous, but they don't want to do what you did to get it, what you got. Oh, y'all don't like me no more. Praise God. I live in a condo on the beach. I'd like a nicer one, but I'm happy with what I got. And I travel a lot. So maybe it might have been a year, maybe 2 years ago. I came home one time from traveling. You praying the Spirit? I came home one night from traveling, and there was cockroaches everywhere, little tiny ones, you know. They're like everywhere. I'm like, what in the world is this? Like, there's no food sitting out. You know, my daughter has moved away from home. There's no Cheetos under the, you know, carpet. No ice cream under the bed. You know, there's no reason why I should have all these little roaches. Annoying. So I called the exterminator. I said, you know, in the building, you got to come and you got to deal with this. They came, they dealt with it. About 2 days, it was good. Then they come right back. I'm like, what is this? So I leave. I know. That's what I said. So I left. I went traveling. I came back again. And boom, and it's like all over the place. They're in my printer. They're like crawling out. I'm mad. I'm like, this is not me. My house is clean. You know, there's no reason for this. So I called the condo manager again. They said, oh, we'll do something about it. I said, you know, you need to do something about it. I got all those bug bombs. I put them everywhere. The kind you have to leave because it's toxic. You'll die if you stay in the house. I thought, this is going to kill these suckers. And I put them there, and then I went out of town. I came back home. Roaches everywhere. I'm like, this is dumb. I called the conversation. I said, you will get somebody out here, and you will fix this now. Like, this is not my issue. You need to fix it. It's nasty. So I, with a capital N. And so they sent somebody out, and they came, and they looked around, and they went upstairs, and they came back downstairs, and they said, here's the thing, we found the problem. They said, the people above you are from Canada, and they're only here a few times a year, and they have an infestation in their house, in their condo. It's just, it's bad. It's an infestation. And because your wall is connected to their wall, all the prophetic people just caught it. Because you are aligned with them, because you are connected with them, because you are living in line with them, you're getting the infestation. So they bombed that place, and then my problem was over. So the lesson is, who you're aligned with can actually have a very bad detrimental effect on your life. If you're aligned with somebody that's in sin, if you're aligned with somebody that has a massively wrong thinking, if you're aligned with people, you know, here, let me just, because whoever you're aligned with, you're going to have some of their warfare. Did you know that?
Yeah.
You know, if we're running together and we're aligned and we're really walking together, then when you go through warfare, man, I'm there. When I go through warfare, you're there. So you're partaking in the warfare. And then not only that, but here's what I learned. If you can be aligned with a really good person that's still the wrong person. Wow. It doesn't mean the person's nasty. It doesn't mean they're bad. It doesn't mean that they're evil. They could be on fire for God, massively awesome, and you're still not called to walk with them at that level. And so you've got to discern who you're aligned with. In this mega shift, I'm convinced that some of you are wrongly aligned. And that's why you're struggling. And sometimes that's what comes back to the sacrifice. Are you willing to let go of some people, of some places, of some things? Some of you need to quit your job and get a better job. You're miserable there anyway. They don't pay you enough. Find a new job. Don't quit before you find one now. Praise God. And number 8, this is the last one. Look for the angels of transition. Look for the angels of transition. I stood in front of the Supreme Court January. It was in January. I stood in front of the Supreme Court, and I was on CBN. They were interviewing me. And they said, what does the Lord say post-election? And I decreed and declared the angels of transition were working in America to bring a transition out of some of the problems that we've seen. Now, we're going to always have problems, but out of some of the problems we've seen and into some new things in regard to religious liberty, the persecution of Christians. And we've seen that, praise God. But here's what the Holy Spirit told me last year, and he said this, listen. He said, many neglect the angels of transition, and they bypass the help I have sent to transition them into the next stage of their journey. Lord said, many ignore the angels of transition and therefore fail to enter into the new place that I've set aside for them at the appointed time. Many are working in their own strength, struggling in the flesh, and failing to embrace the work of my angels on assignment. How about that? I was talking about that long before I wrote the book. My God, the Lord was talking to me about it. To help them transition into the new thing. Look for the angels in times of transition. Praise God. So there's angels that are on assignment that are called to help you. God sends them. The Bible says in Hebrews 1, verse 14, that angels are ministering spirits sent to minister to the heirs of salvation. Somebody say, that's me.
That's me.
Praise God. So the angels of transition. So did y'all learn anything?
Yes.
I want to pray for you in just a minute. I know so many of you came for. We're going to have prophetic ministry here at 2 in just a minute. My prophetic people are going to help me prophesy. Praise God. What I want to do first, I want to give you an opportunity to sow. But I want you to listen to me now. Before you do this, I want you to listen to me. If you sow the same seed you've always sown, you're going to get the same harvest you always got. Some of you, and maybe it's not you, maybe it's somebody online. I'll pick on the online people, let you off the hook. But some of you have a tendency to sow the same thing. Oh, that's your rote, that's your habit. You sow, and that's a good thing. It's a good thing to sow. But sometimes you have to sow an unusual seed to see an unusual harvest. Sometimes you have to sow a Holy Ghost, I'm going to obey you seed, even though this is crazy. You know, this lady Facebooked me this week, blew my mind. She said, I've just gone through just hell, and I'm financially shaking, but the Lord told me to send you half my savings. I said, well, Jesus. I said, you need, you know, pray about that. Like, I don't want to take nobody's, have nobody's savings. You know what I'm saying? And she's like, this is the Lord. Like, she's, I'm shaking all over. This is God. And I'm sending it to you. And I said, well, I didn't even know what to say because I don't want nobody's savings, but you have me. She needs to obey the Lord, so I didn't talk her out of it. I didn't ask her to do it. I just left it to the Lord. You know, I'm praying for her. That's a hard situation. And I don't know if she said that she was mailing it, but the point is, sometimes you have to sow an unusual seed to get an unusual harvest. I'm in this network. I'm the co-leader of it, called New Breed Revival Network with Ryan LaStrange. And he and I were running with three other guys in the network, and those three were not bad guys, but they weren't called to run with us. It was wrong alignment. It was wrong alignment. And so we made a mega shift and began to push, and everywhere we went for the first year of this network, we paid our own way. We just asked the church to host us. We would hold these meetings. We would fly ourselves in. We'd rent hotel rooms, rental cars, the whole nine yards, bring a travel assistance, whatever, pay for all our own food and everything. Never asked for a penny. All we did was take up an offering at the meeting. We did it all by faith. And by faith, we went broke doing it. We were so committed to seeing revival in America, to see people equipped, to see people healed, to see miracles manifest, that we just put it all on our back and just rolled with it. And we just kept coming out in the hole. And it was like, okay, God, we know you've called us to do this. We know that this is your network. This is your idea. Why is this happening? And we could not, we got rightly aligned. That helped a little. But it was just so bad. And we're thinking, do we just need to stop this? And so we had this a double back-to-back conference 2 years ago. I think it was 2 years ago. Ken Malone came down here. James Gall was supposed to come, but his back was injured. And we had a conference down here for the new year. And then it was called The Shift. And then we had, ironically, and then we had a conference up in his church in Virginia, and we had Barbara Yoder. So Barbara comes in. She just came in from Korea or Tokyo or somewhere. And she came in, and we took up an offering. And then she gets up there. She goes, I want to take up an offering for Ryan and Jennifer. And she prophesied over saying that all this neat stuff, awesome stuff. And she prophesied all these things. And she says, I want you to sow into this ministry. This ministry is called of God to go to the places nobody else wants to go. And the Lord would say that you're not to have lack anymore. You're not to suffer and pulling money out of your own pocket anymore. And she began to prophesy. And she challenged the people to sow. And me and Ryan were like, oh, no, man, we already took up one offering. Like, we don't want to, like, take up two. Some churches take up four offerings in one service. We're only going to take up three tonight, so it's okay. We're just taking up one. But so she's challenging people, man. I'm like, oh my goodness, like what? I mean, she compelled. I mean, I would put $1,000 in. I'm like, yeah, that's good. But she was so compelling. I'm like, I'm putting down on that. So I showed $1,000 into that, and I was like, wow. And so we went to the back to count the offering. Joy, Ryan's wife, and I were back there, and we counted it, and it was like $14,000. We're like, wow, Jesus, praise God, because she's like, this is for New Breed. This is for you guys. We want you to, she's like, I want you to take and go all the way, let this be a seed. And we're like, praise God. So we're counting it. Ryan comes back, and he says, how much is it? We're like, $14,000. And we're like, well, we should sow a seed to Barbara out of that. And we're like, yeah, we should sow a seed to Barbara. And Ryan's like, well, what do you want to do? And Joy and I are looking at each other like, oh, I don't know. She's like, what do you want to do? And I'm like, I didn't want to say. I want to be really generous. I didn't know what she would want to give. And I didn't want to, like, overstep my bounds and, struggling. What do I do? And Ryan's like, well, figure it out. We got to give her a check. And so he leaves. And we're, like, looking at each other like, somebody speak first. What do you want to give her? Well, what do you want to give her? I'm like, I don't know. And so I said, let's just give her all of it. And she's like, yeah, that's what I was thinking. I'm like, okay. So we wrote the whole check out, gave it all to her, $14,000. And Ryan came back in, and he's like, man, I'm so excited. We're going to be able to get this TV over here. We're going to be able to buy this stuff. This is like a dream come true. Praise God. We've got it going on. This is going to, all the stuff we needed to get, all these projects we have, it's going to be good. So how much are we going to give her? And we said, we gave it all to her. And he went, and he looked a little annoyed. He's like, are you serious? And we're like, yeah. And he's like, you gave it all. So yeah, we gave it all. And it turned out that she'd been believing God. She supports this big orphanage or some kind of work like that somewhere. I can't remember all the details. And she'd been praying to God for this great need there to be met. And so it blessed the kids. But let me tell you something. We sowed an unusual seed. And it broke a cycle. Because after that, everywhere we went, we had an overflow. Not only did we have an overflow of finances, but an overflow of miracles. One meeting that we did, it was just about this many people there. And the offering was $45,000.
Wow.
That's just God. And there's no manipulation. There's no, you know, selling prayer cloths or selling miracle soap. It was just we just put it out there, and the offering was $45,000. So I want to challenge you tonight to be obedient to God. We're going to pray in just a minute. We're going to lay hands on you. We're going to prophesy in just a minute. How many of y'all could use a prophetic word? Y'all go read your Bible. I'm teasing. But I want to challenge you to give. Be obedient to what the Lord says. As a matter of fact, I want you to take a moment now and listen to what the Lord would tell you to give. And if you hear something like $1,000, don't rebuke the Lord. The devil's always going to tell you not to give anything. But listen to what the Lord would have you to give tonight. If you need an envelope for your giving, raise your hand. You can make your checks to AHOP. If you're online, the unusual seed will bring an unusual harvest. If you're sowing the same thing you've always sown, you're going to get what you've always gotten. If you're happy with that, go for it. But if you're in lack, if you're needing more, if you want to see a greater abundant harvest, you need to sow an unusual seed. I want to give you the opportunity to do that. You can go online, awakeninghouseofprayer.com. I think it's /give. You should be watching this from our site. Anyway, most of you, awakeninghouseofprayer.com/give. You can also go to, if you're international, you can go to paypal.me/awakeninghop, awakening H-O-P for Awakening House of Prayer, paypal.me/awakeninghop. You can also do text to give. Here, you can do text to give here too. Text the word give to 954-320-6744. 954-320-6744. Somebody online, I feel you've been struggling for a long time. There's been something that you lost about 6 months ago. Listen to me. If this is you, I want you to contact me at awakeninghouseofprayer@gmail.com. You lost something very precious to you about 6 months ago. The Lord says he's about to bring it full circle, and it won't look like it looked before. It won't look like what you lost, but it's going to be better than what you lost, and you're going to know that it's him. So take that with you and pray into that, because it's going to happen in Jesus' name. If you're making out a check, you can make it to AHOP, A-H-O-P, AHOP. And if you're doing a credit card, just leave your card in the envelope, and we're going to give it back to you next week when we get what we need, okay? That'd be all right? Praise God. I just don't like to see people upset when I'm trying to make you laugh, because God says he loves a cheerful giver, not a stingy, nasty, mean-spirited, I don't like you giver. Praise God. Pastor Austin, you want to put on Lord of Hosts, son? I think you've got that in the system already. If you want to play that while we move, that would be good. I'm going to pray over this offering here in just a moment. I can't believe 420 fires in the house. Praise God. I got me a t-shirt. It's too small. I'm so disappointed. I did.
You're too small for you, too. They weren't small.
Ready to give? Not yet. I like your shoes. Everybody's looking at your shoes now. Father, I thank you for the opportunity to sow into your kingdom an unusual seed. For an unusual shift. In Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord, that you bless this offering. You bless these givers, God. You return it back to them a hundredfold, God, or more. Maximum blessing in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. Shaking down, pressed together, running over. Men shall give in to their bosoms, God. I thank you, Lord, for divine connections. I thank you, Lord, for unusual appointments. I thank you, Lord, that you will cause them to enter their Kairos time in such a way that it would blow their mind. I thank you, Lord, eye has not seen, an ear heard, nor entered into the heart of man what you prepared for those who love you. And we love you, God, and we're asking you, God, in Jesus' name, to let this seed pave the way for a magnificent shift of finances, a magnificent shift of health, a magnificent shift even of prodigals coming home, a magnificent mega shift in Jesus' name. Praise God. You can come and bring your offering. Pastor Austin, I'm going to crank that music up out here so you don't have to, and then we'll turn it back down if you need to.
With the sin, the storm. Something very unique. The Lord has given you a very unique anointing.
anointing, and it hasn't fully manifested yet. There's sometimes even you wonder, what am I even supposed to be doing, God? Or what am I fully called to do? Like you see part of it and you think you know it. The Lord says, what I've called you to is very much greater than what you can see. I've put a unique anointing for you to reach unreached peoples. The peoples that nobody else wants to reach. The Lord says, I've given you a unique anointing to reach them. The Lord says, if you're willing to go after them, I will count those souls to your credit. Because not only will you preach the gospel to them and bring them in the kingdom, but I've given you a twofold mantle where you'll preach to them, and then you'll clean them up. In other words, there's a deliverance mantle on you. It's not just an evangelistic thing, because that part doesn't, it's not that you don't love souls, but that part's not, doesn't necessarily jazz you. And like you love people and you want to see souls saved, but the evangelism part's not really your main thrust. But the Lord's going to give you influence with the unreached, the lost people, the people that people don't want to reach, just by being you, not by going out preaching, but just by being you. And he's, but it's this deliverance anointing that once they get saved, you're going to help them walk into freedom. So Father, I thank you for that mantle of deliverance in Jesus' name. I thank you for that very unique, it's like a twofold anointing in the name of the Lord to win them and clean them in Jesus' name. The Lord says, because you demonstrate the love of Christ, even when with what the world will call the unlovable, I will cause you to grow in this anointing, to grow in this grace, and my glory will rest upon you. And even those who have thought, well, she's not doing anything special, there have been some that in your family that didn't understand you, didn't understand that special call, they're going to see it, and even some of them are going to come to the Lord in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
That's a good word.
Saw in a picture on the internet, James Dawg going, ah, ha, ha, We're all going to lay hands on you, praise God. If you fall over, well, bless God, somebody will catch you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Glory.
that tonight for many of you was a reset. And you needed a reset before you shot forward, because there were some things that were miscalibrated in your life, but they've been reset in the glory. You know, anything can happen in the glory. Did you know that?
Yes.
We worship Him in spirit and in truth. Praise God. Did you have a good time tonight? Say hello to somebody you don't know.
Amen. Y'all need this tonight? I needed this. Amen. Yeah. Let me pray over you. Father, Lord, we thank you for every single individual that's underneath the sound of my voice, God. Lord, I thank you for what we have been imparted here tonight, God. Lord, we thank you that the former will be greater than the latter, God. And Lord, we thank you for this next half of this year, Father, will be our greatest year yet. Father, we love you, we honor you, and we thank you. And we will finish this year strong. And we thank you for it in Jesus' holy name. And all God's people said,
amen.
I said, all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Go with God and we'll go with you.
I'm over here coughing that stuff. I can't deliver.